Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. Tonight, it's the new owner of the Los Angeles Times, Dr. Patrick Soon-Shiong.
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
He's a biotech billionaire determined to cure cancer and now on a mission to restore the Los Angeles Times to greatness under local control. During our conversation, Dr. Soon-Shiong outlines his vision for the Times and tells me what he likes and doesn't like about the paper as it exists right now.
What I don't like initially is how I don't see the important stories being on the front page. That's the first thing I sort of looked at and said, is there a relevance that we need to identify? I also think we need to very clearly differentiate news, for which I will have very little role other than appointing Norm Perlstein and let him have complete independence, integrity on that, from opinion.
A candid, in-depth conversation with the new owner of the Los Angeles Times, Dr. Patrick Soon-Shiong, when we come back. Dr. Soon-Shiong, thank you for joining us.
You're welcome. Glad to be here.
You are, you've returned the LA Times to local ownership. Many people are very happy about that. You are a billionaire multi-times over. You could have purchased anything. Why the LA Times?
You know, I think the opportunity to make an impact, the opportunity to save democracy, opportunity to have freedom of press, freedom of expression, freedom of thought.
Don't we have those things
already? Well, that's what we need to sort of make sure we protect, right? Not only for the country, but literally for the world, I think, and the opportunity to do this and give back. It's not a philanthropic exercise. It's really, I think, an important exercise that we think I can make an impact. And, you know, if not us, who would? And that's the opportunity.
You say it's not a philanthropic exercise. Do you have to make money? Is it a for-profit venture in the way that it has been for other owners in the past?
Well, it's not a business opportunity from a certain that I went into this on this ailing industry to make money. I think it has to be sustainable, though. Mm. So, you know, I think what's happened is good journalists have been underappreciated from the perspective of their passion for their work. And we need to find a way to not only support these journalists, but to really increase the revenue potential outside of advertising. So it's not a business from a sense that it's going to make a lot of money. It's a business that's important for it to be a self-sustaining enterprise.
Mm. When I was an intern at the LA Times in the 80s, it was at the height of its importance and impact as a newspaper. It had, I believe, some 1,200 employees, bureaus around the world. It was a truly national, if not an international newspaper. Right. It no longer is. And I wonder, with 400 employees, a handful of correspondents doing amazing work around the world, but not the, you know, many, many bureaus that once existed, do you want to rebuild the newspaper to what it was at its heyday, or is it a different property today, and what do you envision as the LA Times?
Well, we have to rebuild, right? I think it has been devastated. If you look at the model of the Washington Post and model of New York Times, they've rebuilt, and that's, I think, one of the basically secrets of newspapers, in the sense that the lifeblood are the journalists down at the ground. So if you look at Facebook and you look at Apple, Google, where news are being sort of usurped in a sense, and even news stations, right, that really don't have the capacity to have 400, 500,000 journalists out there. I think that's the strength and the lifeblood. So the answer is yeah. But we also
the answer
have
is yes, what?
The answer
back
is yeah.
1,200
no,
journalists?
I think I'm not sure what the exact number is. I think what we need to do is have good, talented people that have the capability of doing stories, but taking advantage of technology like what we're doing here. We're doing a podcast, we're shooting some video, we'll be streaming. So we'll be able to reach audiences differently. I've watched, frankly, how now newsrooms actually have robotic cameras that actually move around, all computed. So we can use technology to increase, I consider, productivity of the production. But you can't use technology to increase creativity, journalistic skills, intellectual curiosity. We're not there. I don't believe in that as AI, so to speak. So if you stay taking technology, the good side of technology, and you increase productivity, but you enhance that with what I consider intellectual curiosity, you'll have good newspapers. And that's what the experiment we're going to be doing. I've moved the paper to, we made holes in every floor so that the entire building is interconnected internally, so there's collaboration. And we've modernized this so that there's not just news, but entertainment, sports, food, culture, test kitchen. So this is the I think, the new era, the next generation. But the newspaper must and will survive.
But gave up that beautiful, old, iconic building in downtown L.A.
It's old and it's iconic, and it's beautiful. but we won't lose that. Yeah. One of the things I'm about to build is a museum. Right on this campus, where we'll have children, high school children, and see the printing presses of the past to the printing presses of the future.
When you looked at the LA Times, as I do every day, there must be some things about it that you like and some things that stick under your craw. And I just wonder if you could sort of list what you like about the paper and what it is that you think needs to be changed.
Yeah. Well, first of all, I think we have a tradition of being a national paper of importance, right? In an international paper of importance. What I don't like initially is how I don't see the important stories being on the front page. That's the first thing I sort of looked at and said, is there a relevance that we need to identify? I also think we need to very clearly differentiate news, for which I will have very little role other than appointing Norm Perlstein and let him have complete independence, integrity on that, from opinion. And if we do have opinion, I think we should take not only strong opinions, but own the opinions, meaning there should be a name associated with that opinion, an author associated with opinion. And I also believe that we should have a balanced opinion, meaning you should have the left opinion, the right opinion, the middle opinion. Because we are this heterogeneous population. We reflect, I think, the nation. We should reflect the nation. So the opportunity for us to have this voice of one truth, information, and opinion has to be clearly reflected in a new style so that there's some consistency to the reader to know what they're seeing, when they're seeing, what they're seeing. We will bring back a thing called Column One. I will announce here, this will make some breaking news with you, I'm thinking of creating a column called The Second Opinion. Think about a doctor having a second opinion.
Yeah.
Thinking about you having a second opinion about climate change. So there is an opportunity for us to create these columns, so to speak, or features that are of interest to the reader.
We love it when people break news.
But really it is. I think I've been having these discussions where, you know, I see patients all the time. I still see patients. And what bothers me is when doctors get upset when a patient goes for a second opinion. And I said, listen, it's so important that no matter what disease you have, you seek out a second opinion, because art and science are medicine is still much a combination of art and science. And that's, I think, in lots of things in life. And so this is where we have an opportunity to create a second opinion. If it has to start in medicine, that's where we will do that. You know, I just saw today about breastfeeding. You know, is breastfeeding good for the baby or not? You and I talked about diabetes. I think breastfeeding has a lot to do with actually onset of diabetes or not. Now, that's a second opinion, which we can talk about later on, the second opinion.
I will press you on that on another date. Today, though, I do want to focus as much as I can on the LA Times. And you and I grew up at a time where we read a hard paper newspaper. In fact, you in Port Elizabeth, South Africa, used to deliver the local newspaper in the afternoons, I believe, as a young boy.
Yeah.
And so we both appreciate, I think, the print, but there is a generation coming up behind us who they can't imagine buying a newspaper. They read it on their phones, their tablets, their right. computers. And I wonder, what about the LA Times? Is the newspaper version, the hard paper version of the LA Times, at some point going to go away?
If we have to be the last man standing printing, we'll be the last man standing printing. Let me tell you why. It's not just nostalgia. I worry, actually, about this next millennial generation because of the mobile device. Your brains are being rewired, so the attention span of that is this short. If you ask any young kid today, do they read a book from cover to cover, physically it becomes painful, actually. I think about the print as not just a tactile field, but the concept of leisurely reading. If you had a piece of a newspaper, you put it down, you don't have a fear of losing that page, you'll pick it up again. Mm. This hyperlinking inside digital is taking away the opportunity for leisurely reading, important long pieces. I think that's what we need to become, analytic long pieces inside. And this is how I think we'll bring value through this subscription type model for both print as well as the mobile devices. But I really think the tactile importance of the leisurely reading of a physical paper is still important, mm. will be important.
Speaking of the digital side, the LA Times has been so far behind. When you compare it to other major newspapers, the New York Times, 2.8 million digital only subscribers, Washington Post and Wall Street Journal, about 1 million apiece, the LA Times, about 138,000 digital-only subscriptions. What went wrong, and how are you going to change that? Or do you need to change that?
Well, what went wrong is nothing was done, actually. I mean, I don't consider we even have a digital system as of yet. So, you know, I think August 1st, in the sense where everybody will be together in the same building, we will completely revamp the mobile platform. But the mobile platform, I believe, should be a platform of value. Imagine being the LA Times downloaded app, and you press a button and you have a video conference call with your doctor. Imagine the LA Times where you press a button and you can actually see a trailer of a movie. Imagine if you press a button, you have a live streaming of whatever, of access to an e-sports game. So these are the kinds of things that we need to bring to what I call a mobile platform, where it is, in fact, a platform, not just a mobile digital version of a newspaper. And I think that's what's gone wrong.
I think a couple of the criticisms that one hears in the community about the LA Times, one, it isn't always responsive to the community, and two, isn't reflective of the community and the diversity of our community. Would you agree with those criticisms, and what would you do about that?
To a degree, I would. I think one of the things that we're about to launch is LA Times Español. We have the largest Hispanic population, but a very few journalists. We have a large Korean population. Somebody tells me it's one of the biggest Korean populations outside of Seoul. We have a large Asian population. And so the opportunity for us to really get into the community and actually provide information of interest to that community is really an opportunity that Washington Post doesn't have, maybe New York Times closer. We have this large demographic and amazing market to address.
And in terms of reflecting the community, both in terms of diversity and being responsive to the community, I feel like at times the newspaper, I think, well, that big story is happening, but the LA Times ignores it or thinks, you know, covers something happening in, you know, some other place. When we have such a vibrant community here in Southern California, many communities in Southern California, is the local coverage as in-depth as you'd like it to
Well,
see
I think
it?
This is a reflection, sadly, of the deterioration of the numbers of journalists that we had out there. You know, when we went from 1,200, you could have people at all different spots, and now with 400, it's difficult. I'm still proud of what they've done. It's amazing what they've done with the people that's remained. the stories they've done now, for example, at USC is an important story that they broke. And in investigative reporting is still important. Dirty John, which you may know, is a podcast and was amazing investigative reporting from our reporters. So this will have to now expand and being given the ability to have metro reporting. We've got such a vast expanse of a geography. Los Angeles Times is not just Los Angeles Times. We go all the way to Orange County and even together with San Diego Union Tribune down in San Diego and up and down to Santa Barbara. But the answer is, yeah, we need to improve on that.
As someone who's such a big sports fan, are you pleased with the sports coverage in the LA Times?
Well, look, I think I've watched the basketball, and, you know, we have fantastic reporters there. The reporters on the reporting on the baseball. But I think, look, this is the only city that on a national stage has two NBA teams, two football teams, two soccer teams, two baseball teams. And again, the sports editor and Norm and I are sitting down and says, we need to be the sports paper of the nation, actually, sports paper of Los Angeles and sports paper of the nation. So we're going to increase our sports journalists, so we're going to increase and create podcasting capability, and even all the way into esports.
The LA Times has had three editors in 10 months, five publishers in 4 years. When you stepped into that newsroom, before the employees who now work at the LA Times under your ownership, you received a standing ovation. I think there's a lot of expectation and hope in you. And I just wonder, what has the reaction been in your interactions on a one-to-one basis with some of these journalists who have felt like they didn't have the proper leadership over the past few years?
And, you know, I've met one-on-one with a lot of these journalists. And as I said, I see journalists very much like what the scientists that I have in my organization, and I spent 25 years with scientists, that they have the joy for discovery. And they also have the joy for the truth. They also have the joy for publishing. So if you look at that, that's the passion. So these journalists are there not because of money. They actually are there because they love doing what they do.
Yeah.
And I don't think people recognize that or have had the leadership to provide that. Norm Pilstein, who has come on board, has not just been a storied and almost a legend in journalism, understands them deeply. So we are on the hunt for great editorial staff. You're absolutely right. The leadership has deteriorated. Chris Wisselman is joining us literally this week. From a design perspective, she'll cross between editorial and digital. So we need to actually bring on people. And what's exciting is we're getting calls now, unsolicited calls from some of the top editors in the nation, saying they're really interested in considering talking to us.
Who are they?
Can't tell you. Nice try.
I'm a journalist. That's what I'm supposed to do. But you are getting interested. An energy that's coming.
Amazing energy, and it's very, very fulfilling to know that, in fact, people do believe that this can be resurrected, and it will be.
I want to give our listeners and our viewers a chance to get to know you better as a person, and I wonder, you met with President-elect Trump right after the election, and immediately people jumped to conclusions and ascribed things to you that maybe they're true, maybe they're not. But tell us about that meeting with the President-elect Trump.
Right.
And to the extent that you want to, tell us about your political point of view.
Sure. Well, it's very clear what my political point of view is. I'm an independent. Truly, I mean that in all sense of the term, in the sense that my pure goal is outcomes. I'm interested in outcomes. I'm a surgeon, like a fighter pilot. We're just interested in outcomes. So I'm interested in any human being, so whether right or left, who truly is committed to an outcome that's a benefit for all. so, you know, I worked with the left and I worked with the right. And when I got this call from President-elect, who asked me to come to see to Bedminster and the same day that Mitt Romney was being interviewed, I not only was surprised but was thrilled to say that he was interested in hearing about healthcare.
Mm.
So this is, as you clearly understand, a very complex issue, and was also interested to hear about our work on cancer. So when I arrived there, he gave me access to all the cabinet members. And believe it or not, we spent 6 hours briefing the cabinet members and then had dinner. And I was invited back several times. And to me, what this was an interest to learn of the complexities of what can affect all Americans. So if an American has cancer, you don't ask, are you a Republican or a Democrat? You ask, how could we help you? What can we do to not only leave it, and how could we cure it? And I had the same conversation with President Clinton, I had the same conversation with Vice President Biden, same conversation with President Trump. So I don't believe the work that we do has a right or left leaning. I think the work that we do, and I will work with any and every administration that says we want to actually improve this country's and the humanity of and the well-being of Americans.
Well, Dr. Soon-Shiong, I just want to say that we wish you success both in your fight against cancer and in keeping the LA Times in local control. And it is such an important institution in our community that we wish you success with that as well.
Thank you so much for having me.
If you'd like to hear more of my conversation with Dr. Patrick Soon-Shiong, go to the Frank Buckley Interviews podcast, where you'll hear an uncut version of our conversation. It's available wherever you listen to podcasts. If you'd like to give us some feedback on Frank Buckley Interviews, tag me on social media. I'm Frank Buckley TV on Twitter and on Instagram, and there's a Frank Buckley Facebook page as well. And if you want to share the show with your friends around the world, you can share the entire show when we post it on YouTube on Monday evening. Just search for Frank Buckley Interviews. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.